Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. My name is Leslie Albritton. I am the project coordinator and one of the managing attorneys for North Carolina Legal Aid's disaster recovery project. And I'm very excited to be joined today on our Free Forum Friday by Mike Sprayberry, who is the director of North Carolina State Emergency Management, and Will Polk, who is deputy counsel for North Carolina Department of Public Safety. As we move into a very active hurricane season here in the state of North Carolina, we are going to talk today about preparedness and recovery tips for natural disasters, both from the perspective of state emergency management and from the perspective of an attorney who deals with natural disasters all the time, and give the public hopefully some pointers and some information that you may not typically think you need to know when it comes to preparing for a natural disaster. Director Sprayberry, I will start with you and ask you the first question. Can you explain for everyone what state emergency management's role is in natural disaster response and preparedness?
Well, really, we are the lead agency for natural disasters preparedness, recovery, planning, response, mitigation, all of that. And so we have a team of about between 200 and 250 people, a lot of field staff. And what we do is during a blue sky day like today, we're constantly training and making sure that people are ready for whatever types of hazards are coming their way. We train with what we call an all hazards approach. In other words, whatever the hazard is, you can pretty much apply a basic template to it based from the incident command system. And so you just shift things a little bit. For instance, if we had a right now we're having the COVID-19 pandemic. We have a technical lead, and that technical lead for the state emergency response team is Dr. Mandy Cohen from the from DHHS. If it was a avian influenza, it would be the state veterinarian from the Department of Agriculture, and so on and so forth. If it's a natural hazard, typically, I'm the lead for that, and we bring in all of our state partners, volunteer organizations active during disasters, our federal partners, and our local partners to respond to those types of storms. And I will say that my partner here, Will Polk, plays a really critical part of what we do. We have a command table, and he sits at the head of the table, and he helps ensure that I don't make foolish decisions, which I'm, you know, it can happen to anybody. And so we've had a pretty busy week last week with Hurricane Isaias, and that pretty much hit Brunswick County very hard, as well as some other counties, and unleashed a tornado on Bertie County. With fatalities and injuries. Then we had an earthquake this Sunday in Sparta, which really didn't get on a lot of people's radar, but we're now doing damage assessments. We're over 500 homes damaged. So we do everything from preparing for the Republican National Convention to natural hazards. And you know that I work with one of the parts of my organization is NCOR, the North Carolina Office of Recovery and Resiliency, which we're so grateful for all the great work that y'all do in recovery, not just with NCOR, but with my recovery section in EM. And so, I don't know, I can talk for hours about this, Leslie, but I think you probably want to hear some from Will too.
Well, thank you. Will, that's a good segue into a question that I have for you. You're an attorney like I am. I think that people often don't understand why one would need an attorney or need to be thinking about legal issues in the wake of a natural disaster. Can you give us an overview of what your role is as an attorney, and also some legal problems that you see people experiencing after natural disaster that they might not think of?
Well, first of all, thank you for having me, Leslie. I really appreciate the invitation and opportunity to speak with you all today. As far as legal issues, in my role as a counsel to the Division of Emergency Management, first of all, as Director Schneeberry noted, it is an all hazards type of approach. And I think 2020 and even prior to that has shown us the multiple levels of the Emergency Management Act, which is in North Carolina, the Emergency Management Act is the legal authorization and authority that the governor has to execute the emergency management functions on behalf of state government. There is a local counterpart to that as well. So there are county and municipal emergency management agencies as well, because all hazards, our mantra in here, begin and end locally. So many times events never rise to the level of the state emergency management agency. They're actually handled at the local level. And so there is the ability at the local level to deal with emergencies, but also at the state level, my job, as Director Schneeberry noted, is on a blue sky day, we're always preparing for the next event and making sure that we are well positioned through contracts and procurements and our training, our team. The legal team is working together with our operational partners to identify any issues that may come up during a response, and then of course after response, the recovery from a storm. So that's some of the day-to-day type of operations that we deal with. Whenever we do have events, like Director Schneeberry noted, we are an all-hazards approach, and so with our typical, prior to 2020, before we had this global pandemic, our typical things have been pretty much natural disasters. And so since in the last 2 years alone, we've had severe storms, Hurricanes Dorian, Michael, Florence, Matthew. So people are very familiar with that, as well as winter events as well. So, so some of the legal issues that come up out of those typical events that the state has been experienced and seen are issues related to, issues around housing for homeowners, for example. In eastern North Carolina, one of the major problems we've seen post flooding events from Florence and Matthew has been title issues. And I mean, especially given legacy title issues where folks may have been, grandma or mom or dad passed away, property transfer to the children or grandchildren, but there's no legal documentation to show that title transfer happened. And so one of the programs that was set up after Matthew, the Community Development Block Grant Program for Disaster Recovery, CDBG-DR, those are many of the issues that they are dealing with helping in the long-term recovery for Eastern North Carolina. And some of those issues that do come up are title issues. So that's one example of how disasters can impact individuals. Of course, not having flood insurance, that's been a perennial issue. Doesn't necessarily have to be a hurricane. It could be a really bad, rainstorm or flash flooding event that could cause an area to have damages from floods. And if a person doesn't have flood insurance, how do we get that property back in the shape that it was prior to the event? With the pandemic, COVID has added a whole nother wrinkle to some of the issues that we face. And so we're trying to, of course, recover from these pre-existing events, but also now with this global pandemic, which no one honestly could ever foreseen happen in the way that has unfolded. There's the added challenges of like unemployment insurance, or if you were already in a precarious financial position to begin with, due to those prior events. Now we have eviction issues that have come up and utility issues that come up, which we've tried through the Emergency Management Act to address some of those issues, with moratoriums and the things that the Chief Justice did to put pauses on evictions and the utility commission working with the investor-owned utilities to suspend payments, and of course the governor's executive order. So those are some of the issues that, you know, that from a typical event that we're used to seeing to something that we're not used to seeing is a, you know, those unintended and unexpected consequences of those events. And then also, you know, also understanding that these programs that we do have under the Emergency Management Act, both at the state and federal level, aren't designed to make people whole. So I think many times people anticipate that, oh, well, you know, we'll get FEMA assistance or we'll get Small Business Administration assistance or whatever, and think that's going to make them whole. But those programs really aren't designed to do that. So again, if there's some pre-existing insurance gaps in coverage, and that could get exacerbated by your typical natural disaster event or now a global pandemic.
And I'm correct that if folks do get are able to get into that CDBGDR fund, I say that 20 times a day normally, and which we know in North Carolina is known as Rebuild NC. There is some insurance, homeowners insurance coverage assistance that's provided there if they get their homes repaired or replaced by that program, correct? So people may be able to fill the gap that way for a little while.
And that's one of the other things too with those programs. And I know there's been some pilot programs that we've been looking at, thanks to the, not only from FEMA, but also the General Assembly stepping up and working with us and trying to provide flood insurance for 1 to 2 years for individuals at least get them back on their feet, get them started. But of course, again, you know, one of the things that disasters do have a way of doing is, you know, really stripping away the sort of Band-Aid on and realize how precarious many people are even pre-disaster. I mean, these issues weren't caused by the disaster. Many times these areas are already economically depressed, or you know, you have pre-existing issues as far as domestic issues, childcare, whatever the case may be. And the reality is that whenever disasters, whether it's natural or pandemic, hits, it just basically rips away that Band-Aid and really exposes the pre-existing structural issues that were in those areas to begin with.
Very, very true. Director Sprayberry, and I guess I ask you this next question in the context that we're in right now, where we are in the middle of a global pandemic, which has really changed, I think, probably your answer to this question. But what is the best thing from a safety preparedness perspective that people can do right now to prepare themselves for a natural disaster?
Right. So that's a complicated question by just what you said with the, you know, the COVID-19 pandemic. And so, you know, what we tell people to do is go to readync.org website, and it will tell you how to build an emergency kit for a natural disaster. This year it's going to be different. It is different because with COVID-19, you have to have, you know, additional things like a face mask, cloth face coverings, hand sanitizer, gloves, things like that. Because if you end up somewhere, maybe like a congregate shelter, you're going to want to protect yourself as much as possible. And really, even if you're not in a congregate shelter, if you go to a hotel or wherever that you go and you're not at home, you want to make sure that you have the right personal protective equipment to make sure that you don't contract the virus. That's one thing. And so the other thing I would say is that, you know, people need to listen to instructions, you know, by their local officials and what they're telling them about how to respond to a disaster. And so we know that oftentimes folks are told to evacuate by local officials and they don't do it. I mean, very low percentage evacuates. And so we need them to follow those instructions and then go the shortest distance possible, which will get them out of a impact area. And then try to have a plan in place to where you can stay with family or friends rather than go to a public shelter, because, you know, there's three there's a three pillared strategy for our fight against COVID-19, and that's testing and tracing, that's isolation and quarantine, and then prevention. And so we're being pretty successful. We've actually flattened the curve pretty well. I think yesterday was like 6% of positives of the numbers tested, so not so bad. And but we're still in the middle of the fight. And so when you have people moving around out there, like large populations in a natural disaster, that really exacerbates the situation, and it makes it more difficult for us to, you know, stop being in contact with each other. And so our strategy this year has been to not open large congregate shelters where you have a large number of people in like a gymnasium or an arena or something. And it's been to focus on hotels, non-congregate sheltering, where people evacuating would report to what we call a reception center that's coordinated by the county. Then they check in there, and then they further get directions to a hotel where they'll be greeted by somebody from the Red Cross. We'll take their information, brief them up, and find out what their dietary needs are. And so you can imagine this is a pretty complex operation, especially if you have large numbers of people. And, you know, we're wanting people to take their kits with them that's going to have important papers, medicine, PPE, et cetera. And so it just adds a layer of complexity to the operation. I think that we had a pretty good dry run here with Hurricane Isaias, but it wasn't the volume that we expected. So now here's the question, and we've been talking about it. Did people heed our advice and have a solid plan in place? And did they evacuate their friends and family, or did they just not evacuate? And so we know that in Brunswick County on the barrier islands, there are a lot of people that just didn't evacuate. We saw the results of that with what they call floaters, cars floating around, and multiple fires where cars were parked, batteries shorted out, and they caused fires in the structures. I actually visited the Brunswick County EOC yesterday to talk to them about lessons learned. And a lot of, you know, here's the question. So, you know, you see a low, what's characterized as a low grade storm, tropical storm, category one hurricane coming in. And they typically, people don't pay attention to it because but that only says the wind level. What they need to be paying attention to was the fact that it was predicted to have 3 to 5 feet of storm surge. That's 3 to 5 feet above the ground, plus it was a lunar high tide, and so full moon high tide. And so, but I would tell you that I think that our local partners are doing a pretty good job at telling folks what they need to do. Folks need to listen. And I have to say this too, and I think Will alluded to it, there's people out there with pre-existing conditions. They're not in a good place before the natural hazard strikes. And these are our historically marginalized populations. They're living, you know, there's a reason why they live in a flood zone. That's because property's cheaper, houses are cheaper. And so I think that the first line of defense is flood insurance. And if we could get some way, and I don't want to sound like a socialist here, but if we could get some way of, I know I'd be pilloried, but if we could get some form of universal flood insurance that would be based on a very small tax of everybody in the nation, what's the one hazard that creates the most damage in the United States? Flood. And if we could get flood for everybody, that'd be great. We also have to have more stringent codes as far as where people build. And I know that's not a popular sentiment either to have, but you know, you have people building and building and building in places that experience repetitive floods all the time. So you have to, I guess what I try to be is more than just an emergency manager, but you have to be a little bit of a philosopher, a little bit of, you know, thinking about a strategy of how you can mitigate these things. And I'll just end it by saying we're pleased with the DRRA, the Disaster Recovery and Act of a couple of years ago, 2018. And what's happening is this year we'll be able to get the BRIC, Building Resiliency through in Infrastructure and Communities, $500 million competitive grants, and we hope to do a lot of good mitigation work here in North Carolina. And with that, I'll get off my soapbox.
That's all excellent information for people to understand. And at Legal Aid, we talk a lot about the pre-existing conditions as you've described them, where our marginalized communities are in these particularly flood zone and disaster prone areas for a reason. It's not a coincidence at all. So I get on that soapbox too. So I appreciate your soapbox. And it sounds, to circle back to the sheltering piece, it sounds like the message is that people are definitely safer evacuating if that is the call. If they have a choice between their concerns and their anxiety over COVID-19 and staying in a situation where the impact of a natural disaster is going to be unpredictable, that state emergency management has taken great strides at this point to keep them safe if they have to evacuate. And that needs to be what they do.
That's the message. And I think you've heard the governor say that. If you are ordered by your local officials to evacuate, do it. Don't be concerned. I mean, you obviously you have to be concerned about COVID-19, but don't let that override your concern for, you know, being drowned. And, you know, so you want to get out. And so that's what we would say. You get the order, you go the shortest distance possible, and then you go back as soon as it's, you know, you can, once they give you the all clear.
Right. We've talked about the safety perspective on preparedness and what you need to do. Are there legal pointers you can provide to people in terms of getting prepared for a natural disaster? And you've already talked about some of the legal challenges people face. Are there things people can do on the blue sky days with maybe the help of a lawyer or on their own to get themselves in a better position?
Yes, there is several things you can do, and some will require, you know, will probably need the assistance of an attorney. For example, I mentioned issues like title issues. If there is no good clear chain of title or evidence of that for those airtight properties, either that's where, for example, legal aid and others or pro bono attorneys or law firm who may have reduced fees or whatever can help you get those types of real estate issues resolved, so that when an event happens, you're hoping to get either aid either from your private insurance or from a government agency, you'll have that legal documentation in place. And then other legal documentations that again you could or may not need to have an attorney help you with is, of course, drawing up your will, having living wills, for example, power of attorney, so that if you're for whatever reason incapacitated and need someone to help manage your affairs, you know, that's a very important and easy tool that you can to put into place, so that someone can act on your behalf if you're incapacitated for any type of any kind of reason from the event. So also, you know, insurance, of course, again, you know, there's always the things that you can do on your own that doesn't require a lawyer, as far as just getting inventory for your property, making sure you have adequate coverage, depending on the types of hazards that may be in your area. And then, of course, I mean, and we're finding too with the earthquake that just hit, and the Director Sprayberry has noted in our team meetings that many of the individuals up there didn't have earthquake insurance. So, which again, as some of those unforeseen things you don't think about here in North Carolina, but you know, Western North Carolina, there are faults, and they, and then I know this was a big event over the weekend, but there are many little, we see them all the time in our office as far as the little small reports of little moderate little mini quakes in that area. So, so that's, you know, that's another thing. Medical is another, making sure you have all your immunizations in check, you know, all the records for that, your health insurance papers, those types of things, prescriptions, again, having them in your disaster, in your emergency kit, in a, you know, sealed container, or, you know, however you just, you know, there's, you know, you can go to readync.org, and we have many great tools as far as helping individuals construct their emergency kit to prepare for storms or other natural hazards. So those are things you can do as far as having things in place. Also, as far as landlord tenant, making sure you have your, understand what your lease says as far as termination, as far as what happens if you are displaced, you know, how, you know, making sure you work with your landlord, working with your property company with those issues. So, because again, especially here during the pandemic, we're seeing a lot of that too, with landlord tenant issues popping up, with issues related to rent payments and those types of things. So, and then on the contract side too, for small businesses, you know, one of the, I can remember early on in the pandemic, with events having to be canceled, and you know, maybe had contracts and agreements for certain events, and there was an force majeure clause, something many lawyers probably don't think about that. I had thought about that since probably law school or whatever, but you know, that was one of those things that did come up with having to cancel events for due to the pandemic and having protections in place for that. So for our small businesses, you know, those are types of things to look at as well, as far as your contracts, if you are a small business owner, and making sure that you have adequate protections in your agreements, so that you know, due to a natural or any type of hazard that comes up, you're adequately protected if there is some issue as far as performance or lack thereof because of the natural disaster. So, so I know a lot of folks focus on individuals, but small businesses are heart, lifeblood of many communities, and those are some of the things that they need to be looking at too whenever they're preparing for events. And this pandemic has showed the wide range of legal issues that come up, in addition to the ones we've always known about from hurricanes and other natural events like tornadoes, et cetera.
And we tell people here at our office that, you know, that the process for long-term recovery, for instance, accessing those Rebuild NC funds is long. And so when you apply, it's a good time to, if you haven't done so already, make a will, make a power of attorney, so that as you go through that process, there's someone to handle the recovery and preserve that, help you preserve that asset of your home if something, heaven forbid, happens to the applicant during that time frame while you're waiting to access those funds and get through the process. And that's something obviously folks can contact us for, or another law firm. But I know we've been talking for about 30 minutes now. I could keep asking you y'all questions all day, but I want to end on two notes. It sounds like ReadyNC is the place to get the best and most up-to-date information. And I believe, is there an app that people can access and put on their smartphones?
That app was retired, and so, okay. But that's that readync.org, and you can go there, and it's also smartphone friendly, and so you can get everything that you need there.
I'm going to share that www.readync.org in the chat box for folks, and also our website I'll put in there. And then I guess my final question for both of you is, COVID-19 has certainly been something that is unprecedented in my lifetime. But is there any way either of you can think of that the challenges may make our disaster response better in the long run?
That's an excellent question.
I like to be positive.
I think that I'll tell you something. First of all, I want to tell you and your team that, you know, that we really appreciate y'all. And you guys have always been really ready to step up to the plate and assist us. I mean, disaster after disaster after disaster. And so it's like my boss, Secretary Hook, says, he says, you know, Mike, he says, since I've been here, we've been marching from one disaster to the next. And I said, sir, we're not marching, we're jogging. Maybe that somebody said that. But anyway, I would tell you that we're grateful for y'all and what you do. Relative to COVID making us stronger, I think it's important that everyone knows that as the state emergency response team, we knew our DHHS partners very well. We met with them frequently so that we understood the dangers of upcoming pandemics. We talked about Ebola, and we did talk about COVID-19 as it was emerging in China. I will tell you, and I've told other people this, I was a little bit arrogant about how I felt about it, because I felt like our healthcare system here, our strategic national stockpile, all of that would be, you know, we were well positioned to fight it. And so little did I understand there was somewhat of a balkanization of our country and how we approach the COVID-19. And so I think, you know, some people, I read even, I think as like yesterday, there's a sheriff somewhere, he's ordered his deputies not to wear a mask. And I'm sitting there thinking, okay, doesn't make sense to me. But I think in the end, what's helped us is we've come to be better at logistics because we've had to have a better handle on basically operating and getting a lot of, we spent over $300 million, Leslie, $300 million on PPE. And so the governor's strategy is to basically ensure that everybody from migrant workers to people that work in meat processing plants to people in the court systems to schools, healthcare, everybody's got PPE. And so and we've been partners with DHHS on that. So we've learned a lot in that respect. I think a big thing that we've learned, and you're probably laugh, is we've been able to operate the EOC virtually. And so last week during Hurricane Isaias, there weren't very many people at all in the state EOC, where normally we would have a couple of hundred, right? And so, and I think that we did a pretty fair job in our response. So we do learn things, and we kind of learn what we can do when we're pushed up against the wall. One of the other things I think that we can say is that we are beginning to understand what it means to be activated for month after month after month, and we think that we'll likely be activated probably for another year until the vaccine is developed. And we have to figure out a way to make distribution in a very methodical and intentional way where you are incorporating knowledge about cold chain storage, which is, you know, you have to keep the vaccine at a certain temperature and all that kind of stuff and who gets it first. And so, we've learned a lot. And I will tell you that you can see right there that young Attorney Polk is working at the state EOC. We've had leadership at the state EOC like for months. And so we've learned to work together. We've also learned to work virtually. Partnerships are stronger than ever. Another thing that we've learned is I actually thought that NCOR was going to slow down in that whole process. They've actually stayed on pace with their spending and construction. And so proud of those guys. And I know how well y'all support them. And so those are just some thoughts off the top of my head, ma'am.
All right. Thank Thank you. Will, do you have anything to add to that?
Just real quick, echo everything that the director said. I think one of the things that from my perspective is lines of communication and teamwork is definitely, because we haven't been having to work in a virtual environment, it has strengthened resourcefulness as far as communication. I know from the legal side, our legal team is my team, our general counsel of the Department of Public Safety, our counterparts of the Department of Health and Human Services and the governor's office. We meet twice a day throughout this pandemic. We have the standing meetings at 9 and 4 to address all the various issues. And so, again, because this is a multidisciplinary event, and so that many issues that have come up over the course of this operation we were able to triage it and have our virtual law firm of being able to troubleshoot issues and implement the governor's executive orders and provide good counsel to our client agencies as these issues have come up throughout the pandemic. And also, as I mentioned before, our baseline law that we operate from is the Emergency Management Act. And one of the things that this pandemic has shown the how robust and how flexible the governor's executive authorities and emergency powers are, and how well constructed I think our state Emergency Management Act is as far as being able to deal with the all hazards. And I think when we did the modifications of it in 2012, it really was with the all hazards approach to it, and the subsequent amendments that have been made over time as we've had different events. But for me as an attorney, I have, and working in this space for many years and working with this particular statute and also our public health folks, we're seeing the flexibilities of the laws and also the limits of the law, quite frankly, as far as how we can deal with various issues. So it's been a great learning exercise for that, from that standpoint, as an lawyer as well.
Well, we here at Legal Aid really appreciate both of y'all's time today. I know that y'all are incredibly busy right now, and we're always very grateful that you're willing to talk to us and work with us, even though we're not always in agreement about what should happen. We do appreciate your time so much and the fact that you're willing to talk to the citizens of our state live and let us throw questions at you like this. So thank you all so much for your time today. I don't see any questions in the chat box. I think we'll leave it there.
Thanks, Leslie. One team, one mission, one family.
Thank you so much. It's a pleasure, and always look forward to working with you.
Thank you.